One of the things that makes Vilna so remarkable is its pre-war Jewish community and the incredibly rich cultural history in that space. Vilna is a complex location. It is multinational. In 1939, it's a Polish state, but it comes under various administrations over the next several years. It's multi-ethnic. It is a place that has almost every variety of a Holocaust experience that you can imagine. They have a very significant ghetto. They experience shooting actions. They experience deportations to the camp systems. So it is a place that is very uniquely situated geographically, so that it touches all of these complex systems that are thrown against the Jewish community. And in the midst of that, it is this incredible Jewish culture that finds a way to respond, not always an active armed resistance, but some version of a personal or spiritual resistance. And that's what we're here tonight to discuss, and what I think comes to life so beautifully through the music of the play that will be at the J in April. Just a quick housekeeping note, as we're moving through this evening, please put your questions in the Q&A feature. I'll be back at the end of the presentation to moderate those to Shelly. But it is now my pleasure to introduce our speaker for tonight. You might be thinking to yourself, this is a really complex topic. Who did they get to cover this? I said this exact same thing at International Holocaust Remembrance Day. Who's gonna handle something this complex? One of my great joys in managing our work is that we have the benefit of having Dr. Shelly Cline on our team and her expertise and her vast knowledge. You will see that she is not only gifted with the history, but she's very passionate about speaking about places that she has been to. She has been to Vilna. She loves Vilna. And I think you're going to see that come through tonight. In fact, you may notice the map behind her as she moves through this evening. So I'm going to turn this presentation over to Shelly.
Thank you, Jessica, for the introduction, and certainly for setting us up in such a nice way to springboard into, as you say, this very complex topic. So I will share my screen and we will get started. Oops. There we go. All right. So to begin, I think many of you on here may know exactly where Vilna is, but I think one of the first questions even that Keith got when starting this production from people who, attended some of these samplings of the music is where is Vilna, right? So one problem with modern, today we know it as Vilnius because it is now in modern day Lithuania. But where is it? Where was it then? How has that changed? So let me briefly take you through some history here. If you look at this map, and there'll be a few maps here in the beginning, you'll see going all the way back to the 13th and 14th century, what this area of Eastern Europe looked like. And I think for many of us too, even for those of us who are, avid readers of history, I think a lot of people tend to have a very Western-centric knowledge of Europe and European history. So sometimes this area of Europe really falls outside the purview of what we're usually hearing about. So again, this shows you some of the territory in very, very early modern times. But when it comes to Vilna, it depends on the year where it is. So here we have Vilna when it is included in the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth in the 17th century. This was like the height of its territorial extent. And then following here in the 17th century, we will see the partitioning of Poland. And so that will be the time when Poland is divided between Prussia, Russia, and Austria. And the part that we're concerned with, Vilna, it will be absorbed into Russian rule. Now, this has several implications for its Jewish population, because it really is in this earlier period here in the 17th century that we see a large Jewish influx into this Eastern territory. A lot of Jews were fleeing actions in Western Europe. There were more restrictions on Jews in Western Europe during this time period. And so they moved east because they were, you know, offered a bit more freedom and possibility in this territory. So you see that movement into the east. But once this territory comes under Russian rule, then we'll see some restrictions come and go. And I think that's a really important thing to keep in mind, one, about Jewish life in Europe in general, but certainly about Jewish life in the East here. The level of freedoms and extent of violence will very much depend on the ruling power that they are under. So you'll see that in this period, really from the end of the 18th century into the beginning of the 20th century, Russia holds it. Now, that said, there will be a moment during the Napoleonic Wars where Napoleon will get over there and there's like a bit of a tussle. So it's, you know, there's still some influx that's happening, though it is, and it's still technically held by Russia. We will see some pogroms in the beginning of the 20th century, like we saw in other parts of the Russian Empire. They too will make their way to Vilna, and I'll speak a little bit about that later. Sometimes it's German. From 1915 to 1918, so over the course of the First World War, Germany will occupy Vilna. And I'll speak a bit more about that as well. At the end of the war, we have a bit of a mess. So at the end of World War I, during this, from 1919 to 1921, it will go back and forth between Poland, Soviet, and Lithuanian authorities. In total, in the 20th century, I believe Vilna changes hands a total of 12 times. So sometimes it's, you know, going back and forth between the same powers. That just gives you a sense of the complexity and the difficulty of everyone living within there in terms of how you adjust to some of these political changes. So there is this really back and forth period that happens during the Polish-Soviet War, which, fun fact about that, the Poles win. The Poles will defeat the Soviet army, and it is the last time the Soviet army loses until the Afghan-Soviet War in the 70s and 80s. So kind of a cool thing that the Poles do win at this moment. And because they do, that's when Vilna will really be absorbed into the Second Republic of Poland that we know in this interwar period. The Treaty of Versailles established the Western boundaries of Poland. It was only really after this Polish-Soviet War that we get the Eastern borders more settled. And again, eventually through the Treaty of Versailles, we get the establishment of Poland. And you can see there, Vilna is included within this Polish territory. And then sometimes it's Soviet again. And so as we'll talk about more, that it will go over to the Soviets once World War II begins. Germany will invade during the Second World War as well. And then finally, the Soviets will take it over in 1944, and they will keep it until 1990. So that's actually the most simplistic version of the back and forth that I think is possible. There's definitely a more complicated way to go through it. So if you are interested in this particular geographic area, it's a fascinating story, and one that is even more complicated than this back and forth. So the next thing I want to hit on before we move forward, and both Jessica and Keith mentioned this a little bit, and that is this idea of what is resistance. Because I think sometimes it's easiest to see that some resistance was armed resistance. And here we have Abakovner's group of Vilna partisans. But there's a wide variety of responses that happened during the course of the Holocaust, and particularly within the ghetto system. And so I'll talk more about this as we get into it. But I just want to set that tone that we should think about a broader definition of resistance, that it doesn't have to be armed. It can be, as Jessica said, it can be spiritual, it can be artistic, it can be setting up a soup kitchen, it can be, you know, the simple act of sending your kids to some sort of school because you believe that they're going to be alive in a year, right? So there's a variety of ways that we have to think of this resistance story. Because in order to fully appreciate what was lost in the destruction of Vilna and the Jewish community there, I think it's important to establish what it looked like. And so I wanted to back us up just a little bit. I won't take you back to the 17th century for this, but to the 19th century. And so if we look at what Jewish life in Vilna looked like in the 19th century, we do see, while there has been, you know, constant Jewish life there since the 17th century, we see a continued growth, a more of a flowering here in the 19th century. Interestingly, there were some prohibitions against Jews settling in villages, new immigrants settling in villages. And so people would move to Vilna, which increased the Jewish population of Vilna. It also led to some overcrowding and unemployment in that initial sort of adjusting period. But you can see here at the very end of the 19th century, Jews are making up 40% of the total population. So that, again, it's a city where not only was there rich Jewish life, but the numbers were significant in terms of the overall population. You can see that there's a variety of industries that Vilna's Jewish population engaged in, be it, you know, industry, factory work, but then also pharmacists, lawyers, that sort of thing. So really, you know, crossing all different classes. There was a lot of schools and education systems that developed during this late 19th century period. Both Hebrew and Yiddish literature will flourish. And as many of you know, Vilna becomes really famous for its promotion and study of the Yiddish language, especially promoting it as the language of the diaspora. So again, you can just, I listed a few here, just to make, you know, hit home that point that Vilna is a place that is filled with art and artists and education and theater and all kinds of just exciting things. It's an exciting time to be in Vilna. And there's also a variety of political organizations as well, Zionist groups, the Bund. So competing ideas about what the future of Judaism looks like. And again, this makes for a really interesting place because it is such a, there's such diversity there amongst the Jewish community. Early 20th century life. Here's the picture. Here is a postcard that you could, you know, pick up in Vilna, and it shows people standing outside of one of the synagogues. In 1900, there was about 100, I think maybe 105 synagogues existed in Vilna. So again, that gives you a sense of the diversity of the community, the size of the community, that there were 100 synagogues when the 20th century began. By the end of World War II, there would be one. And today in Vilna, there is exactly one synagogue. So it continues in this time period to develop as this center of Yiddish and Hebrew literature. And also there's a lot of publications that happen. So a very literate group. Also, there was a lot of Jewish people who had lived in Vilna and then immigrated outside of Vilna, but then still considered themselves part of that community. So they would publish in publications in Vilna, even though they were not living there anymore. So that also gives you a sense of the identity that people felt to this place. So they may be living in New York, but they still felt that they were part of that Vilna community. The Russian Empire will ban Hebrew print houses. And so they only allow two in the Russian Empire, and Vilna is one of those that's allowed to stay open. Again, just highlighting the amount of educational institutions that existed, vocational institutions, also charity organizations. So you get a sense too of the community taking care of itself. And then it's also during this period, so there's all these positive things happening in terms of culture flourishing. And yet, as is so often the case with Jewish life in Europe, there can be a site of violence as well. And so while the pogroms that Southern Russia experienced, they don't spread in the same way to Vilna, but there are some attacks, and certainly there is anti-Semitism that is felt throughout this period. And in 1900, there was a blood libel accusation that a Polish woman claimed that Jews had tried to murder her to use her blood to make matzah for Passover. And so surrounding that incident, there was some increased violence, which also meant that because of that violence, as had been the case in areas of Southern Russia as well, it meant that people would begin to leave Vilna. So there were an increase in immigration during this period because of that increased violence. And there was a worsening economic situation as well. So the two things together did mean that there was an increase in immigration. Then comes World War I. And like I said, the Germans will take over Vilna during this period. And here we have a German postcard that was taken. The photo was taken during the German occupation of Vilna. So there is, the occupation is, as any occupation can be, you know, certainly not preferable. They confiscated food and merchandise, and some Jews were forced to do forced labor. But during the time period, you know, Yiddish and Hebrew schools still continued, new schools opened. So I just think it's really important to make this point that even though Germany occupied Vilna, you know, in 1915, they're there. This is a very different occupation than what will happen not that many years later when they come back in 1941. So in 1915, more of a usual military occupation. And in fact, what that was in some ways, when there was talk of the Germans occupying Vilna again, some people, not necessarily the Jewish occupants, but some people thought, well, I mean, this can't be that bad because the Germans were here before. So because there had been a pretty recent memory of German occupation, there was a hesitancy in some cases to believe how bad it was going to get when the Germans came the second time. Interwar Vilna, again, so a lot of the positive things that had been happening at the beginning of the 20th century continue, only now Vilna is a part of Poland, and I explained why earlier. It still it has the standing as one of Europe's most important centers of Jewish life, so that continues. The standing of the city itself decreases a bit because now it's incorporated into an entirely new country, a country, you know, Poland didn't exist prior to this. It hadn't existed since the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth in the 17th century. So it's part of a new city or a new country. And there were some economic troubles during this interwar period. And I, you know, we always say interwar, but of course we have to always keep in mind that the people living through this period didn't know it was interwar, right? For them, this is the post-war period because they don't know that another war is coming in this time period. I just have a few, you know, a couple of, you know, one, a painting from the period that shows to the artistic tradition that continues in Vilna during this time. And there, a lot of photos that you find of Vilna come from this interwar period because prior to that, cameras were not widely available. After the interwar period, you know, so much of Vilna is destroyed. So you can find a lot of photos of Vilna, particularly of the Jewish sections of Vilna. Interestingly, they come from this interwar period. They don't come from the Nazi period, but it would be very easy when you look at these photos because there is a often there's a level of poverty that's captured in some of these areas that might make you think, oh, it's actually they're capturing photos from the ghetto from the German period, when really they're just capturing photos from areas of Vilna that were not, you know, that were impoverished because of this economic downturn. YIVO is established as well. And again, I mentioned before, this is an institution that continues to this day that is dedicated to the study of Yiddish. And in this time period, they were very dedicated to making Yiddish the language of the diaspora, as opposed to, so it's kind of, you know, competing with Hebrew in a sense. So this is an institute that would collect, you know, not just current volumes of people writing in Yiddish and about Yiddish, the study of the language, the use of the language, but they were also collecting documents from earlier periods of Jewish history as well. So they collected medieval manuscripts and things from, you know, the Renaissance and whatnot. So they were really looking to be a big depository of artifacts and literature. And they accomplished that. Of course, this would be problematic once the Germans do invade Vilna. So we'll talk more about what happens to those items here in a minute. But again, this is a really, you know, a major hallmark of Vilna and its culture. At the end of the war, well, the Germans will take some of the items that they in the YIVO Institute, and they will take it back to Germany. Eventually, those items, along with the ones that were left, will be transferred to New York to begin the Institute anew. So that leads us to the beginning of World War II. And the first thing, you know, we know that happens, that kicks off the war, is the dismantling of Poland. So Poland as a country, the Second Republic, doesn't last very long from 1921 to 1939. It's done. And it happens, you can see, with the Germans invading from the west and the Soviets from the east. Germany and the Soviet Union had a public pact, the Molotov-Ribbentrop pact that said that they would, they have a non-aggression pact so that should war come, they were not going to fight each other. But then they had a secret agreement within that public pact that said they would divide up Poland, which is exactly what they do. So you can see on the other map here, you can see the portion that is of Poland that is annexed directly into Germany and will be administered as a part of Germany proper. You see this middle section, which is the general government, which would be occupied by German troops. And then you see the pink section, which is the portion of territory that involves Vilna. So this is the section that is ceded to the Soviets. They will eventually really take it. But it will be administered in that way. When the Germans come into the western part of Poland, and you can see eventually when they will move into the rest of it, they set up a system of ghettos. And so this too is, you know, just a moment to talk about where we are in Nazi policy. At this moment, when the Nazis are moving into Poland, they do not have a plan for the final solution. There isn't a plan to murder all of Europe's Jews. What they have instead is a situational solution where they're putting people in ghettos. Keep in mind the population, the Jewish population of Poland is around 3 million. This is the largest Jewish population that the Germans have had to deal with. So they have significant numbers of Jews to deal with. They don't quite know what their end goal is at this moment, but they do start ghettoizing people, especially in major cities. And so we'll see that policy extend to the rest of Poland once there is an invasion. Of course, that's the policy that will be applied to Vilna as well with the establishment of the Vilna ghetto. So initially, with this dividing of Poland, it is under Lithuanian and Soviet rule. And I put those together because it isn't technically occupied by the Soviets until June of 1940. But it's one of those Soviet puppet state situations that we're familiar with more in later periods. So basically the Soviets tell the Lithuanians, you know, we're going to put some military bases in your territory. You can have a perception of rule, but this is what we're going to do. In gaining those, that pink section of the map that I showed you of Poland, Stalin is really acquiring a buffer zone. So he knows that Hitler is headed east. Like, that's no secret. He doesn't think that this you know, non-aggression pact is going to last forever. He's just buying himself some time to get the Soviet Union ready for war. And so this territory, this, you know, the eastern strip of Poland, he sees as a buffer zone. It's something that he's going to use to sort of slow down the Nazis before they get into the Soviet Union proper. In June of 1940, Vilna will now it had to agree to the military operation. But then in June, the Soviet troops will move in. So you can see a photo on the top, the Soviet troops moving into Vilna the same day that the Nazis are marching into Paris, taking Paris. The Soviets are marching into Vilna. So you can tell, like, the world's eyes were not on Vilna. They weren't on the east. They were very much looking at what was happening in Western Europe. But the Soviets were now militarily moving into these states. And the US officially issues a statement of, like, we don't agree with the Soviet Union absorbing the Baltic states, but that is in fact what happened. The bottom photo here shows you, this is actually a Lithuanian soldier who's looking over the city. So this is something that will hold true throughout Vilna's wartime experience. The Lithuanians are always there, and they're in many ways very willing to work with the occupying power. So in the lower picture, you see this is a Lithuanian soldier who is now going to be working for the Soviets. When the Germans come in, the Lithuanians will work for the Germans. So and that, of course, leads to a lot of collaboration in perpetration when it comes to the Holocaust. Once the Soviets have occupied Vilna, there is a banning of all organizations, is true for all the Lithuanian territory they take, there's a banning of all organizations other than communist ones. So that means that all these Jewish youth groups that were flourishing, ones that become resistance groups during the Holocaust, all of those then have to go underground, because the only thing you can be during this time period is a communist. So you will see a lot of Jews flee during this period. They will leave the city. Initially, before there was outright occupation, you did see an influx of Jews fleeing from other fleeing from the territories that had been taken by Germany, the west of Poland. People came east, but once the Soviets are actually occupying Vilna, you will see people fleeing, fleeing the city. So I think that's important to keep in mind, that, and I think the actual occupation of Vilna is often kind of, the Soviet occupation is often kind of overlooked, right? Because we think about, you know, what happens when the Germans come in, but there was a moment where the Soviets are also there. And I think that adds to this story, and also adds to a dimension, like I said, when it comes to what the locals are doing. And they were willing to, you know, help out one set of occupiers, willing to do it again. In the midst of all of this, we'll see a good deal of anti-Semitism. In June of 41, so the Soviet occupation of the city doesn't last all that technical occupation. Again, I want you to think of this like what the Soviets are doing very much in their puppet state. You know, that's the way that they operate, where they're not technically there, but they're controlling it. So even if they're only militarily there for a short period of time, they were technically controlling what was going on. So that's important, that it wasn't entirely under free rule, essentially. In June of 41, we have Operation Barbarossa. So again, we see the German troop movement quickly sweeping through into Soviet territory. Now, of course, the first territory it's going to get to is the territory that was originally given to the Soviets. So it'll be Eastern Poland. But that Eastern Poland, that section of Eastern Poland, now has the experience of not only Blitzkrieg, but increased actions of the Einsatzgruppen, or these mobile killing groups that came through and especially targeted Jews. They in some cases killed other resistors and political leaders as well, but when they move into the Eastern territory, their primary goal is to find communities of Jews and to murder them. So the German occupation, as I mentioned, will look very different than the Soviet occupation, and it also will look very different from the German occupation of 1915. Germans enter the city on the 24th of June, so operation starts on the 22nd, and they're there by the 24th, so they do move in really quick. There's about 60,000 Jews that live in Vilna at this time. It's about 30% of the population, so it's not as high of a population percentage-wise as had been earlier in the century. And again, a lot of this unrest meant that people did leave, whether it be some people left, and if they were able, left the continent. Some people might have gotten deeper into the Soviet Union, especially as they saw the Germans heading eastward. So we do see a movement of the community here. There are immediate murders and restrictions on the Jewish population. So very, very quickly, Jews are forced to wear an identifying badge, a star. There are shooting actions right away, individual murders. So it really starts immediately. These shooting actions will take place at a location about 10 miles outside the city called Ponari. It was a popular picnic site before the war. And when I visited there several years ago, people were picnicking there still. So it's, again, just a forested area outside of the city. But during this period saw the numbers are, you can see here, according to German sources, the initial shootings were around 30,000, a little less than 30,000. In total, people estimate that it was about 70 to 100,000 people that were murdered in these, in the forests of Ponari outside of Vilna. You can see where the shooting action is taking place. These are pits that were dug by the Soviets to hold fuel. So again, thinking back to what that Soviet occupation looked like and that Lithuania had to agree to Soviet military bases within the country, this was part of that landscape. They dug these pits to hold fuel for war. They didn't end up filling them with fuel. And instead, when the Einsatzgruppen comes in behind, so like the Wehrmacht would take territory and then the Einsatzgruppen, these mobile killing groups would come in after, they will repurpose these pits to be the site of these mass killings, which, you know, sometimes, as many of you who have read about the Einsatzgruppen, sometimes they'll use ravines, sometimes victims are forced to dig their own graves, but where possible, they will use something that's convenient. And so these pits were convenient. So you can see from some of the photos, that's what's happening there. People are being taken. The initial shooting actions take place in July, and really from July until December is when the big killing actions will happen. There'll be some that happen later, especially when the smaller ghetto is liquidated. And it always remains there as a potential murder site, but the bulk of the killing does happen relatively early on. And then at the end, when the ghetto is liquidated, there'll be further shootings. If you look at the photo on the bottom corner, you can see the soldier standing there is a Lithuanian. So this too is, again, another example, another instance where you'll see, you know, the German Einsatzkommando is in charge of it, but then there's also a good deal of local participation in these killing actions as they move forward. This is also a site that once the ghetto is liquidated in 43, then they will have a commando mostly of Jewish forced laborers that are tasked with exhuming the bodies that were buried in these pits and burning them in an effort to hide their crimes. So while there are shooting actions that are happening, then we also see the establishment of the Vilna ghetto. So initially, there's sort of two sections of the ghetto, the small ghetto, ghetto one and ghetto two. The larger ghetto had about 30,000, the small had about 11,000. The smaller ghetto tended to have people who were less able to work, and eventually that smaller ghetto will be liquidated both by shooting actions at Ponari, and then also the remainder will be put into the larger ghetto. So eventually there's just one main ghetto. There is a period of relative stability that happens between, like, after December 41, the bulk of the shooting actions really stop. And so until 43, when the liquidation happens, there's a bit of a hiatus, essentially. So in this period, we can look at what life in the ghetto looked like. So, and I'll kind of compare this to other ghettos as I go along. But as in all of the ghettos, really, throughout this time period, there are, like, life is difficult. So there's usually overcrowding, because these ghettos exist in, you know, parts of town that were usually undesirable. And it's a small area that lots of people are crowded into. So given that the starting point is already not great, when you cram a lot of people into this geographic space, the sanitary conditions get worse. And so in the Vilna ghetto, in many ghettos, you will see that there is a higher rate of mortality because of these conditions. There will be lice, there will be disease that strike. And so that makes, of course, life all the more difficult, in addition to the fact that people are not getting much food. So this, you know, every ghetto is administered a little bit uniquely, but by and large, all of the ghettos, the point is not to, they're not giving much rations, essentially. So people are weakened, which makes them more susceptible to disease. What's interesting about particularly Vilna and some other ghettos as well, but Vilna does a particularly good job of this. They have a ghetto hospital. They have departments, surgical departments within that, and a clinic that's open, 24 hours a day. So they're really, using, again, the people who are there. They use the specialists that they have from within. Now, is this a normally equipped hospital? Of course it isn't. Do they have access to the same medicines? No. There's going to be a lot of smuggling involved in stocking places like this. But the point is, there's a real attempt to maintain health and to take care of each other. The health and welfare department was also very good about, particularly in Vilna. Now, this is, the total population is about 20,000 in the ghetto, so it isn't a huge ghetto, which makes it some of this sanitation issues a bit more manageable. But within the ghetto, the health and welfare workers did they were keen to prevent outbreaks of disease. And again, in a place like Warsaw, where you have 400,000 people living in such a tiny, tiny area, no matter what was done, you're not going to make a huge impact on the overall health of the ghetto. But in Vilna, they did things like collective punishments if people didn't clean their apartments, as you know, in, you know, again, these are all limited. They had limited materials and ability, but they're policing themselves to try and keep things as clean as possible in order to prevent some disease. So again, kind of an interesting situation that they were able to do this. And if you look at the stats, there's a relatively low mortality rate of the Vilna ghetto compared to other ghettos, to which many people ascribe the efforts of this health department. Again, they're already starting in a better spot because of their size. But it is an interesting program that is relatively successful because there's no major epidemic that breaks out in Vilna. There are sports that take place. And this too is interesting because it tells you also a bit about the conditions that, you know, even when they had limited amount of food, a lot of smuggling involved in getting extra food in, but the conditions are such that people could expend some calories on sporting activities. And you can see, here's a quote from one of the people who lived in the ghetto saying that, you know, these sporting events were essential to their vitality and desire to live. So even though, you know, you have to really be careful about where you spend those calories, this was something that was really good for morale, right? So it was a really positive thing that they look forward to doing. And here's even an advertisement, it's like, you know, announcement on painted on the wall of the ghetto advertising that there will be the sporting event that would to take place, and they want people to join in. Music is an important part of the ghetto. And if you think about all the things I listed in terms of what the Vilna ghetto, or what Vilna was before the war with the music and theater and art, all of that, there was a desire to continue that. The people of Vilna wanted to stay, you know, maintain the identities that they had had. And so you will see an orchestra here in Vilna. What's interesting, you don't see the piano in this picture, but it was a piano that was smuggled in piece by piece and then reassembled so that their orchestra could have a piano. Theater productions, whether they be regular theater, puppet theater, children's theater, and these performances were very well attended. You can look at the numbers there, 120 performances, 38,000 spectators, that was active until the liquidation of the ghetto. So again, this was something that was very much a part of resistance. It's spiritual resistance. It's a way that people can maintain identities and also, you know, continue life from before. Here's a quote too, because I think it's important to recognize that even at the time, people were debating, is this appropriate? And so initially, people were hesitant to attend these theater productions. And this is, you know, one man's diary here. He says, in the shadow of Ponari, the shooting site, life is happening and there is hope for a better morning. The concerts were initially boycotted, are fully accepted by the public. And so it was thought, should we be having a theater production when 10 miles, you know, from here, people were, you know, being mass murdered? Is it appropriate? And yet, after that initial discussion, people feel like, yes, this is good for the people there. Here's one, just an individual who was a poet of the ghetto. He was involved in lots of the artistic and theatrical life of the Vilna ghetto, and he's able to escape and takes some of the, you know, artifacts and manuscripts and photos and whatnot. When he escapes the ghetto, he into the forest, he takes these with him. And then the box that you see here was made from like a downed airplane and fashioned into like a metal box so that it could hold these items. So again, we would have some sort of a record of what happened there. Vilna was famous for its library. And this was, here is the library, what the library building looks like today in Vilnius. And the people of the ghetto were very proud of this library. It was utilized by many, many residents. And they have a special like notice and celebration that celebrates the 100,000th like checkout essentially of the library. And I think this is really powerful. He says, books link us to freedom. Books connect us to the world. And, you know, I think that's so much of this cultural life that they were performing was about that, that it wasn't, it was looking beyond the dire circumstances that they had to connect to something else. And so certainly, again, this qualifies in this area of thinking about resistance, what it means to go to the library and read a book. And this library was open 6 days a week. And at one period, it was open even 7 days a week for people to go in and read. So it was certainly something that was very popular and really integral to the life of those who were in the ghetto. Another important part of that makes you know, Vilna significant. And I mentioned the YIVO Institute. So when the Germans come in, the YIVO Institute is actually outside the ghetto. So it is not in the territory that was included in the ghetto area. When the Germans come in, they want to ship back a lot of the Judaica that they find because they're building some sort of a Judaica collection in Frankfurt. And so they force people in the ghetto to work in this institution to sort and catalog the materials there because they don't, you know, probably they can't even read them. So they need someone to go through this. Well, these people are, you know, they don't want to see these manuscripts hauled back to Germany, which they may be destroyed. In some cases, I mean, there's books and whatnot. There's also art and things made of metal that they were certain and probably true would have been melted down. And so the people that are charged with doing this work will smuggle out these documents. And again, some of these were manuscripts going back to medieval times, and they would smuggle them back into the ghetto where they could hide them so that they wouldn't be destroyed or taken to Germany. And some of these, you know, most of them were hidden within the ghetto. Some of them were hidden in a Catholic convent or church. And those weren't recovered until the 90s. So they'd been hidden there and no one had remembered or knew that they were there. But then in the 90s, after the fall of the Soviet Union, some of these artifacts that had been hidden by the paper brigade were recovered and then since returned to the Institute. People tried to maintain their religious identities as well, which again is very important. So they're maintaining other aspects of culture, and religious life was no different. So you'll see religious schools for children, for adults, a continuation of religious practice and celebration and festivals, even though the Judenrat wasn't the Jewish council that was established within the Vilna ghetto and all of the ghettos. It didn't have a particular department to finance these institutions. People still found a way to finance this, the continuation of religious life. There was an orphanage within the Vilna ghetto, which if you think about it, you know, ghetto life, I don't want to paint, you know, they're doing all these incredible things. I don't want you to come away with the idea of like, oh, the ghetto was a good time. It wasn't hard. Ghetto life at its core was hard and difficult. There's always a scarcity of food, of fuel, of adequate clothing. All of these conditions exist. So I want to make that point really clear that in spite of those conditions, these people are able to continue all of these incredible ways of resistance, essentially. But because life is hard, and there's still, you know, there is still disease, there is still, you know, forced labor, there is still random terror that occurs, you know, children will be left orphans. People will be killed, will die. And so kids are left without their parents. And there will be an orphanage that's established to take care of those kids. Additionally, there were schools for children as well. And think about what that means too, that in the midst of all of this, people are still able to think, I want my kids to continue learning, right? It speaks to a view of the future, a view that there has to be something beyond this, that there's an expectation that they're not necessarily going to die, right? If you're sending your kids to school, there is a view that they're, you know, you're trying to maintain normalcy for yourself and for your kids in that moment, and also a hopeful view to the future. And survivors of the Vilna ghetto, ones that were kids, will talk about, you know, what it was like to go to school and, you know, what they were learning. And again, they didn't have adequate materials, but there was still education that was taking place. Vilna is, as the show suggests, famous for its underground movements and its attempts and eventual armed resistance that happened outside the ghetto. There's a variety of underground movements that take place. The most famous one, headed by Abba Kovner. And this is a group made, as Keith mentioned, made up of young people. So the young people in the ghetto were very keen on active armed resistance. And so that's an important thing to note. There's a real age difference, especially in terms of looking at who was able and really willing to see armed uprising, armed resistance as the path to take. So this was one of the groups that was active. They had about 300 members, organized in various commanders. And there's going to be debate both in the Vilna ghetto and in other ghettos who had these underground resistance groups about when to resist. Is this the right path? And you'll almost always see within the ghetto, within these ghetto structures, there's often a tension between those who are the Judenrat, who's officially in charge of administering the ghetto, and then these underground organizations that are pushing for resistance. So for the Judenrat leaders, their goal is to keep the ghetto open. Like, they want to keep it functioning as long as possible to save the most amount of people possible. Those who are in these resistance groups have different goals in mind. And so you'll always see this tension, and that definitely plays out here in the Vilna ghetto. This is a famous proclamation made by Abba Kovner in January of 42. And this is where he says, like, you know, they will not take us like sheep to the slaughter. So what's really important, this is a famous line, it gets repeated a lot. He's, you know, talking about, he knows what's happened to Panari. He doesn't want that to happen to, you know, the rest of Lithuanians, Jews. And so it is this very passionate call to arms. And yet we have to remember that while this is, you know, the view that some people had, it also, there are many people who are not able to resist in this armed way, right? If you are an 80-year-old man, you aren't going to have the same ability to take up arms like an 18-year-old man. If you are a mother with small children, period, you are going to have a different view towards all-out uprising warfare within the ghetto than if you were a teenager. So there's just a real difference in opinion between the inhabitants of the ghetto. And I think what the most important takeaway here is that the variety of opinion is okay. And the people who, you know, thought their best chance was to not take up arms, that's okay. We can't look at, you know, if we see proclamations like this, we can't let it be an indictment of everybody who didn't take that action, right? So there's everyone's under different pressures and different priorities in terms of what's the best way forward. So this underground movement, during this period of relative stability, they're planning for an uprising. They would like there to be one, but it comes, and, you know, while they're planning, they will, some people are able to engage in some, you know, they're gathering weapons, sneaking out things to engage in acts of sabotage outside the ghetto. But at the end of the day, there isn't an overwhelming sentiment by the majority of those in the ghetto to have an uprising. And so there isn't one like what we'll see at the Warsaw ghetto. So this resistance movement that's in the Vilna ghetto, it has connections to other resistance movements throughout the East. A lot of the messages are smuggled out by couriers, which are mostly women. So we have to think, you know, what's really interesting about this resistance movement is that there are a lot of women involved in the partisans of Vilna, in the ones that, again, throughout Eastern Europe, we do see involvement of women in these resistance groups in a variety of ways, whether it be active fighting, whether it be sabotage, whether it be as couriers, spreading messages and other forms of information. So there is an attempt by this underground group to connect to other partisans outside. It's difficult. Again, you have to find these partisan groups in the forest to connect with them. It's just a difficult process. Eventually they do make contact, but it isn't until the spring of 43 and ahead of the liquidation of the ghetto. Most of the fighters of this resistance group will flee through the sewers of Vilna. And there's a particularly powerful song included in the musical Keith was speaking about that talks about this this process of fleeing through the sewers. What's important to keep in mind about this moment where they flee is this is an active resistance group that's leaving. They are not interested in taking women and children who can't fight. They are not interested in taking the elderly. They are looking to get out young, able-bodied people who can physically fight. And so again, there's this sort of, a distinction that needs to be made. They're looking to get out fighters to fight as opposed to getting out people to save as many lives as possible. So I'll show you a good contrasting example here in a minute. The end of the ghetto comes in 1943 when in September, and the ghetto is finally liquidated. Some women and children are sent into the camp system in Poland. Some are sent to Estonia and Latvia, and others are murdered at Ponari. So again, as Jessica mentioned in the introduction, even here in the final days of the ghetto, you're really seeing a variety of experience, a shooting action, concentration, people being sent to concentration camps, people being eventually sent to death camps. So there's a variety of experience that happens here. So in contrast to, I titled this talk Vilna and Resistance in the East, we shouldn't think of Vilna as the only place that resistance happened. Of course, there's various types of resistance happening all over Eastern Europe. And another partisan group that is quite famous, and many of you have probably seen the movie Defiance, which came out several years ago with Daniel Craig, it focused on the activity of the Bielski brothers. And these were two brothers who were not focused on active fighting. They were focused on saving as many people as possible. And so they would sneak out. They would sneak out people from wherever they could find them. They would take women, children, the elderly, and they wanted to maintain a community as best they could until the war ended. And remarkably, they were able to hide in the forest with a group of 1,200 people. So that also speaks to, if you've been to Eastern Europe, you know the forests there are quite dense. But it speaks to that landscape that only in a place that densely forested would that be possible to hide a group as large as 1,200. But again, different groups. Some resistance groups were about active fighting and sabotage, really directed towards the German army. Other groups were working on just saving lives. So different approaches. But again, that diversity is important. As Keith mentioned, there is a song that's associated with the partisan group first in Vilna. It's written by a man who was born and was from Vilna. He is deported when the liquidation of the ghetto happens. He does not survive the Holocaust, but he famously writes this song, Zagmat Kimmel, which goes on to be the partisan song. It organically spreads throughout the East. So really pretty incredible that, again, it's an organic spreading. And so even places far from Vilna, people were singing it, and there, you know, and today there are partisan monuments throughout Eastern Europe that will reference, this song. So I wanted to just play you a very brief bit so you can hear it, because I think it is powerful. And this is something that, you know, if you've attended our Yom HaShoah commemorative service in the spring, it's something that we always play and that is deeply meaningful to many survivors. Kommen wird doch unser ausgedenkte Schoß,
svet apoi këto në nëzër trot mirë zënë ndo. Kumën vetë do kënë zër ojës ke bëngë të sho. Svet apoi këto në nëzër trot mirë zënë ndo. Von grünem Palmenland bis Land von weißen Schnee. Wir kommen on mit unser Pein, mit unser Weh. Ohne wo gefallen, sie ist ein Spritz von unser Blut. Sprotzen wird dort unser Gwur und unser Mut. Ohne wo gefallen, sie ist ein Spritz von unser Blut. Sprotzen wird dort unser Gwur und unser Mut. Svet die Morgensun begilden uns dem Heint. Unter Nächten wird verschwinden mit dem Feind. Nur ein Versammeln wird die Sonne und der Kajor. Wie a Parol soll gehen das Lied von Dor zu Dor. Nur ein Versammeln wird die Sonne und der Kajor. Wie a Parol soll gehen das Lied von Dor zu Dor.
So again, you can sense, you know, it was set to a Soviet tune, but the words were written by Hirsch Glick. Oops. So again, just as a moment of comparison in terms of what else is happening in the East, how does Vilna compare to other places? So like I've mentioned before, there are many, many ghettos, about 400 that the Germans set up in their within Polish territory, and even more within the edge of the Soviet territory that they get to. Mostly in the Soviet Union, rather than ghettoizing people, they by that point have really moved into active murder and are using those Einsatzgruppen shooting actions. So you don't see really widespread ghettoization happen into most of the Soviet territory that the Germans go into. They really just shoot people. But here's a variety of photos from other ghettos. We see there's some from the Ludge ghetto, which depicts soup kitchens and religious, I think it's a Purim celebration that's happening there on the far left, schools. And then I have a few other photos from the Warsaw ghetto. So you can see the milk cans here. These are part of the Oneg Shabbat archive, where as a part of, you know, a different type of resistance, Jews within the Warsaw ghetto were gathering and collecting an archive of both their experience of life in the ghetto and also detailing Jewish life before the war. They collected these documents and artifacts, and they hid them in milk canisters and metal boxes that they buried underneath the ghetto and were able to find after the war was over. So just a really powerful form of resistance. And then you can see the middle photo with the fire. That is the Warsaw ghetto on fire, because of course they did very famously have an uprising, the Warsaw ghetto uprising in 1943, ahead of liquidation. So it was the Germans came into the ghetto ready to deport the remaining Jewish population. And instead, on April 19th, the Jews fought back, and they kept fighting for 27 days until the Germans started burning and destroying the ghetto, you know, building by building, block by block, and eventually deported the remaining 42,000 inhabitants to Treblinka and Majdanek. So we can see here, it's a, you know, thinking about different types of resistance, here we have a very famous, probably the most famous action of physical resistance happening in the Warsaw ghetto. So Vilna is always, you know, in many ways, it is very unique. And in many ways, it also shares commonalities with the experience of other ghettos. Again, most famously, if we look at Ludge and Warsaw. The liberation of Vilna will happen by the Soviets. The Red Army will reach Vilna July 13th of 1944. And with them do come many former inhabitants of the ghetto. Abakovner is one of them. So he and many of his compatriots, when they escape through the sewers, they do find Soviet partisans, or they do find Soviets eventually to meet up with afterwards. And when the Red Army is coming in, they do join them. And this is a brief snippet of a poem that he wrote about Vilna. You know, he says, how do you eulogize a town whose residents are dead, but who still live on in one's heart? at the end of the war, 90% of Vilna's Jews were murdered in the Holocaust. And that figure is very similar to Lithuania as a whole and Poland as a whole. So 90% will die in the Holocaust. And like I said, if you came to the talk I came on International Holocaust Remembrance Day, you know, we mentioned when we think about the destruction of Polish Jewry, we have to think, this holds true for Vilna's, you know, population as well. We're thinking about the individuals, and we're also thinking about the vast cultural life that went with it. As we see the city in ruins, and, you know, again, thinking about there were 100 synagogues at the turn of the 20th century, and there was exactly one at the end of the war, and there is still one today. So what does Vilna look like in its post-war period? So now it's called Vilnius. It is within Lithuanian territory, because at the end of the Cold War, Lithuania became a independent country. Lithuania still struggles with something called Holocaust obfuscation. Many Eastern European countries do. Because of their long decades under Soviet rule, there is a tendency to equate suffering under the Soviets with suffering of Jews under Nazism. So in some cases, I think it's getting a little bit better, but definitely that has been a struggle. You can see, to highlight that point, you can see the one synagogue that is left in Vilnius today. And then the middle picture is the Holocaust Museum, which is administered by the Jewish Museum of Vilnius. It's quite small. When I was there, you know, several years ago, it's a very old-fashioned museum. Captions of pictures typed up by a typewriter. It's in an old house. You wouldn't know it was there unless you were looking for it. Contrast that with this massive building on the side there. That is the former KGB headquarters in Vilnius. And it was, at the time that I visited, it was called the Museum of Genocide. Now it's the Museum of Occupation and Freedom Fights. So when I was there, the word Jew did not appear once. They talked about the partisans of Vilna, including Abakovner, but did not in any way mention that they happened to be Jewish. Now they have added a small section acknowledging the Jewish resistance that's related to Vilna, but it's still very, very problematic. There is a Holocaust Museum. Like I said, there's the Holocaust Museum and there's the Jewish History Museum. There's the Panari Memorial. So in the immediate post-war period, you know, this site where 70,000 to 100,000 Jews were killed, initially survivors put up some sort of a memorial, and then the Soviets took it down. So in 1948, the Soviets take it down and they remove the Jewishness of it. So before, there was a clear statement that this was about, you know, the Jews that were killed by fascists. The Soviets replace it as victims to fascism and remove the Jewishness. In 85, they build a new memorial. And again, it still says, you know, the Soviet people, and then about this, you know, the fascist occupiers, but there's this, like, there's the Jewishness is removed. And we see this happen throughout Eastern Europe. In 91, fall of the Soviet Union, finally the Jewishness of the site is recognized, along with the fact that the majority of the victims at Panari were Jewish. There were some Soviets that were killed there, and there were some Poles that were shot as well. But numerically, it was a much, much, much smaller number. In 91, this ownership of the site goes to the Jewish Museum, and there's still a small memorial there to the Poles that were killed as well. And finally, I think this is a bit of good news, that there is a future memorial museum planned in the site of what was the library. The Jewish library in the Vilna ghetto. So this is what it looks like. Still not great shape, but it was transferred, the ownership was transferred to the Jewish Museum in 2019. It was also made a protected site by the state, so it can get state funding. And the hope is to make this building, which was so central to the ghetto administration, to the cultural life of the ghetto, the sports field that I showed you, the people playing sports, that took place in the courtyard behind it. So it really was a heart of ghetto life. And it seems very appropriate that this be the site for a future museum that highlights the ghetto experience, and that the Holocaust Museum also can be put into this space and more appropriately viewed. You know, the other one is small and people don't know it's there. this really puts it back in a place of prominence. And with that, I'll stop my share and I can take any questions.
Thank you so much for that, Shelly. That was incredibly rich and nuanced and a remarkable presentation. I wonder, to start us off, if you could, as a historian, as a Holocaust educator, talk about what is the differentiation between East and West. What do we think about in Holocaust history and Holocaust education that differentiates East and West for us?
Excellent question. When we think about the Holocaust, we can never think about it as being one experience, a blanket experience, right? So how a Jewish community in the East is going to be very different in how it people experience it in the West. In the East, we do see, Vilna has this, they have a ghetto, they have shooting actions. These are both very much hallmarks of this Eastern experience that speak to the situational solution of the Holocaust that you don't see happening in the West. You won't see Jews of Germany be ghettoized. You won't really see that experience happen within any of the Western countries outside of a minor holding experience prior to, like, an assembly experience prior to deportation. Because by the time they get to the West, they already have the death camp system in place, which they didn't necessarily have when they were dealing with this massive Jewish population in the East. And I suppose that's the other thing to really highlight. The Western Jewish population is so relatively small compared with that of the East. There are about 350,000-400,000 Jewish people living in Warsaw at the beginning of the war. That's more than the entire country of France.
We have a couple of questions about memorialization, which I know is a favorite topic of yours. Beyond what is in Vilna, are there other memorials to the Holocaust and the Jewish experience in the Holocaust throughout that territory, whether it's Lithuanian now or Polish now?
There are. And, the ones that existed, the pattern holds true. If they were put up immediately after the war, they will have that weird Soviet pattern of obfuscating the Jewishness of the experience. And they're now starting to change. So there's one at Kovno, at the another killing sites. There's other places throughout Lithuania where they do have some memorials. I don't think they're quite as significant as the ones in Vilna, just because of the population. But I think we will continue to see the memorialization process, hopefully continue to see it on the upswing.
The other question we have about memorialization is whether or not the stumble stones are present in Vilna or in that general territory.
That's a great question. I don't know if they are or not. They were not there at the time I was, but it's a project that's continually growing. And because there's no geographic limitations on this installation, there's no reason why they couldn't be. Or why an individual family couldn't go to the city and say, I would like to put these stones in. That's usually how the process works. So I don't know of any specifically that are there, but they're being added all the time. Like every day there are more stones that are added.
We also, and I think this is a great set of questions, because even just within your presentation, you've called Vilna several things, you've called Ponar multiple things. So this is a linguistically complicated space. So one of the questions is, what language or languages would the non-Jewish population in this space have spoken in the many years prior, before the war, say 50, 25 years before the war?
That is a great question. And it's going to be a diverse, there's a real diversity. People would have spoken Russian, they would have spoken German, Polish. There could have been some Ukrainian because of the Polish connection. So I would say the biggest languages were probably Polish and Russian, and Lithuanian, of course. There's, of course, Lithuanian being spoken there as well. But what is interesting about Vilnius itself is there's a relatively small Lithuanian population in that city. So language is sometimes the best way to understand people's identity.
The other linguistic question is if you can explain the term Litvak.
I believe that's a Yiddish term. It's a Yiddish dialect, I believe. I don't know that I can say much more than that.
Okay.
I am not a linguist. I will tell anyone who is really interested, especially in the languages, Timothy Snyder, the historian, who writes a number of fascinating books. Most famous, you might know him for Bloodlands. He also wrote one specifically about Lithuania, Belarus, and I'll give you the title of it here, Reconstruction of Nations. And he deals with this territory and specifically with the languages involved going back centuries. So if you are a linguistic person, read this book by Tim Snyder and you will have all of your linguistic questions answered.
I think that we can group this next set of questions into kind of a framework of the porous nature of a ghetto structure. We have some questions about how the economy functioned if they were isolated. And then there are questions about how people were moving, able to smuggle themselves or smuggle some of these items out. And I think there's a related string there that you could probably put together for us.
Sorry, you cut out for just a second. Could you just repeat the first part of that again?
I can. This next set of questions is kind of about the porous nature of a ghetto structure, how things move in and out of a ghetto structure. So there are some questions about how the economy within the ghetto could function if it was isolated. And there are also one or two questions about how people or some of these materials, say the library materials, were able to be moved in and out.
Right. So some of the, the YIVO documents and whatnot. So there's a good amount of, smuggling that's going to happen. Because people are going on work details outside the ghetto, there is an opportunity for people to bring things in and out. And that will differ. Certainly in Vilna, there's an opportunity to do that. In other ghettos, there might be less so because the nature of the work done in that particular ghetto might not allow people to go in and out. And then you would really have to rely more on smugglers who are only leaving the ghetto to come back with stuff, as opposed to people who are leaving for work. And so you'll see people who are, like the paper brigade will smuggle things by, putting stuff in their clothes. And I think we know from, a few accounts that if those people were caught, they were, if they were caught with papers, that was less interesting to a Nazi guard than food, right? So there will be, heavy reliance on that sort of nature of smuggling in and out.
In your presentation a couple of weeks ago, where we were looking at Poland in a broad sense, one of the ideas that you left us with was that the Jewish community is having a little bit of a reclamation of some of the space that had been their ancestral community. And given the climate of Lithuania, the tensions that you spoke about and how the Holocaust has been obfuscated and how that memory is treated, I wonder if you could speak a little bit to what's the current state in Lithuania now.
So Lithuania does, they are one of these countries that still has, there are still squares in Vilnius that are named after Lithuanians who worked with the Germans. So they see them as, they're now showing up in memorialization by the Lithuanians because it's seen as here was someone who resisted the Soviets, but this is also someone who worked with the Germans to murder Jews. So you still see spaces like that but there's a debate about it. So while Lithuanians are not tearing those plaques down, there is a debate to say, from the Jewish community, to say this is not appropriate, we should get rid of those. So you do see some of that. I think the fact that the library is now being turned into a museum is huge. The fact that the Genocide Museum got renamed was mostly international pressure. But the fact that the library has been given by the state, to the Jewish community, that's a huge step in the right direction. The Jewish population of Vilna today is about 5,000, so it's not huge. I don't know how fast it's growing. It's certainly not growing like the Polish community is, but there is still a small Jewish presence that's working very hard to memorialize the space that's there. And I should say too, the Jewish Museum that's in Vilna is very good in showing a long view of Jewish life in Vilna to the best that they're able.
One of our goals here tonight was with the assumption that many people who are interested in this topic may go to see this play at the J, It is based around the story primarily of Abba Kovner and Vic Kempner and their armed resistance, their active resistance that was leaving the ghetto to go commit acts of sabotage against the Germans. You've done a remarkable job, not only of contextualizing that against non-armed resistance, but about speaking to kind of the tension within the community about what was the right course. And I wonder if you could say something about an individual's or a small group's thought process. What would be a catalyst to taking them to the point where armed resistance is feasible for them versus the mother that you mentioned or the elderly gentleman that you mentioned?
Yeah, I think that's one of the things that makes, you know, these places so fascinating. And you think about the real human condition that's happening here, that people are like, we know the end of the story, right? Like we have the benefit of knowing how the story ends. And of course they don't, you know, they don't know that at the end of the day, deportations are going to happen no matter what, right? So they don't know what to us seems inevitable. And so I think on an individual basis, most people who are get themselves to that point of armed resistance, one, you have to be physically able, but for the most part, these are individuals who have nothing left to lose. They're often, you know, in many cases, they don't have parents, they don't have younger siblings they need to take care of. And so there is a certain freedom that exists for them to make decisions that only impact themselves. And that's something that, you know, you see those considerations being weighed out by the leadership of the ghetto, and particularly this ghetto. You know, how can we keep the most number of people alive? And, you know, in the case of Vilna, the ghetto leadership was opposed to an armed resistance because they thought that would bring the Germans in faster and it would liquidate the ghetto. And so they, you know, they're trying to balance how to keep as many people alive as possible, but they don't know the end of the story, which is the goal is for everyone to die.